Well, most people know Larnelle Harris for his majestic tenor voice. What they don't know is that he was the son of a bootlegger. After a legendary half-century career, Larnelle has now written a memoir revealing little-known facts about his very storied life. Take a look.
Hall of Fame vocalist and five-time Grammy Award winner Larnelle Harris has helped to define a generation of contemporary Christian music. With 19 number one songs and countless top 10 hits, his music career has spanned five decades and is still going strong. His story started in the hills of Kentucky as the son of a bootlegger. Larnelle watched his father taken off to jail, battled racial tensions, and even lost his voice, but chose to keep singing for God. Larnelle made his way to music's most acclaimed stages and venues. In his memoir, Shaped Notes, Larnelle shares his most painful and triumphant memories from his childhood and career that helped to shape him into the man he is today.
Welcome back to the 700 Club, Larnelle. It's so good to see you.
It's good to be here.
I understand it's been about 20 years since your last visit. That's too long.
It has been. But one of the most memorable times is when I came to share in Pat's birthday.
Oh!
I forget which century it was.
He tried to celebrate.
Well, he's still kicking and doing good.
He's doing great. Yeah. So you have to come back for the 90th. I'll
take that invitation.
Well, I'm loving your book, your new book, Shaped Notes. And your daddy was a bootlegger. This was after Prohibition. Your grandfather was also in the shine business, the moonshine business.
In the business.
But they went to church.
You know, they did, because it was important. And yet, my mom actually prayed my dad into the kingdom.
Wow.
I mean, it was, and as a little boy, I didn't really understand everything that was going on and the dynamics between, grown-up relationships. But I could tell from the words that this old Pentecostal lady was praying.
Oh, yeah.
That he did not have a chance.
Absolutely.
You know what? And
he
came to know the Lord as his Savior. It was almost windy as like my mom's prayers and the prayers of his friends, as though they put him on a cot and lifted him up to the roof.
Oh, that's beautiful.
And every prayer I can think that they prayed, another shingle would come off that roof. Mm. And until they lowered him down to the face of Jesus.
Well, it was interesting because in your book, you talk about how they didn't really consider themselves criminals. They were, they considered themselves businessmen.
Trying to make a living.
Trying to make a living,
trying
take care of their family,
yeah.
You know?
And I have to tell you, I got a little bit of an education because I could sell you a pint just as good as they could.
Well, thank goodness. That did not happen. So another influence in your life was a lady named Miss Georgie.
Miss Georgia Dunahigh. She taught piano lessons to every kid in Danville, Kentucky, whether they wanted them or not. You know what? And I did not want them, but Ida Mae, my mom, wanted me to have piano lessons. So I took piano lessons from Miss Georgia for a long time. And she figured out that I could carry a tune.
Mm.
I was a boy soprano, didn't sing very much. You know what? You haven't lived till you've lived the life of a boy soprano. So, so she found out I could sing a tune, and she started teaching me the hymns and stuff like that. And in fact, I did my first concert with Miss Georgie at 9 years old.
Wow.
And to tell you the truth, she didn't want anything. She's a wonderful lady. She was just wanting to invest herself in some kid that she met. She really kind of got on my last nerve. She went to my mom one time, and she said, Ida Mae, you should not let Larnelle play any sports in the dust because the dust will hurt his voice. Now, what 9-year-old kid wants to hear any of that?
No, not at all.
But she was a wonderful lady. And now, as I've gotten older, especially as I've gone through this exercise, I hope that every town has a Miss Georgie.
Aww.
Somebody who invests themselves in the
really
kids and friends.
Really helped develop you, yeah. Well, now, before you sang professionally, Larnelle, you played the drums,
I was a drummer.
In a gospel band.
In a group called the Spurlows. They traveled all over the country. It was a group put together by a friend of mine, Thurlow Spur.
There they are.
And, yeah.
There's a lot of females in that group.
There's a bunch of ladies in that group. That was the fun part, you know. But we traveled all over the country for a time, and we would do, at first we were doing driver education safety programs for Chrysler Corporation. I mean, that's what we did. Sometimes 2 and 3 concerts a day. And at night, we'd do our concert called The Splendor of Sacred Songs. And we'd invite the kids to come to our nighttime concerts because we couldn't give our testimony in the daytime. And it was a wonderful, wonderful ministry. But a guy by the name of Otis Skillings came in with an arrangement of Oh Happy Day.
Ooh.
And a couple of the guys and I had went to school together. They said, listen, sing this for them.
Yeah.
And so I hadn't sung anything. I'd been in the group almost 6 months. And then I sang Oh Happy Day, and that became my song. And somebody thought it was a good idea to take a drum set and put it on a platform like this with wheels. It's not a good idea, okay? But we did that, and I started singing the Spurlows. And
Was it around that time that you met your wife, Mitzi?
I met my wife in college at the university, and we had a very, very rocky relationship. She was the grown-up, and I was a kid, and which is still pretty much the same. But now, this coming December the 19th, for those of you who send gifts, 46 years and counting.
Wonderful. Now, I understand early on in your career, in your singing career, you lost your voice for a while. How did that affect you?
Well, boy, it was tough. It was tough. And I had done some recording, and I went around to doctors all over the country, and they would listen to a recording, and they'd listen to my voice. I had sung myself out, I mean, two or three times
a day. You just burned yourself out. You were singing constantly.
All the time.
Yeah.
And high notes and doing everything. And they said, I don't know if you're going to sound like that again or if you're going to sing again. So I had the formation of nodules, and it's like a corn on your vocal folds. And I had to rest. The only remedy was to rest a year. Now, I found out what that was all about because when you can't sing, boy, you start searching. I mean, when you can't do what it is that you believe God wants you to do. And I really bathed in scripture until I figured out what was going on. When I left college, I had a voice and a degree. And,
right.
I was going to turn the world upside down with this voice and had been put my trust in that. This time in my life, God was saying to me, you know what? It's not going to be voice you're going to trust in.
Mm.
It's not going to be the things that you think are important in life. We're going to trust in me.
Right.
And that is a lesson that I've never forgotten.
And then, of course, you went on to win 5 Grammy Awards at least, numerous other awards.
They got to give them to somebody, so they can give them to me.
You've performed at the White House all over the world. You've done so many things. And now you have a new album out called, interesting title, Disturb Us, Lord.
Disturb Us, Lord. This was written by some friends of mine, but in order to get this into my DNA, I remembered a time that I was in Israel and had the opportunity to go into the Garden of Gethsemane.
Yes.
And I floated around there. I tried to figure out where Jesus might have sweat that blood, you know?
Yeah.
And I thought about where the disciples might have slept. And I identify with the disciples, unfortunately. And Jesus, what did he do? He went over and he woke them and he said, can't you just pray with me just a little while? I mean, life, eternal life is in the balance here.
Yeah.
But what did he do? He disturbed them. He woke them up every once in a while. I am so thankful that God puts his hand on my shoulder and shakes me a little bit.
Just disturbs you, wakes you up.
Wakes me up. Disturb us, Lord.
Well, Larnelle, we are so eager to hear you sing, so please walk on over to the music sets right over there. Larnelle's book is called Shaped Notes, How Ordinary People with Extraordinary Gifts Influenced My Life and Career, and I can tell you it's fantastic. His latest CD is called Disturb Us, Lord, Songs About the Cross, both available nationwide.